Corina.
Hey.
Awesome. Here we are.
Yeah, here we are.
Nashville, Tennessee.
Yeah, welcome. Yeehaw. Welcome all the way from Seattle.
Yeah, it's good. It's good to be here.
And so good to see you here.
I had one of the podcasts I had scheduled kind of fell out, which is all right. Someone got sick.
Yeah.
And so I reached out to a couple of friends, Nancy Cohen's daughter and then Arun. And they both recommended you.
Oh, that's so awesome. That's so sweet.
Yeah, so at the last second, you were like, yeah, I'm on my way. And 40 minutes later, you're here.
Yeah. And we were able to do it, you know. The Lord said, okay, go for it. So I, you know, supernatural power. Hello,
come on,
as a woman.
Come on.
Put yourself together, and then the other woman to put herself together and go pick her up and come here. Yeah, we're good.
Well, this is gonna be good. You are like... You're on a lot of things, but one of the things that you're doing is you're hosting these environments here in Nashville, and you're hosting environments where you're really connecting people with various ministers, where it's all about the face-to-face, heart-to-heart, actual encounters with God, where people can really know the Lord and not just know about Him.
Correct.
And I would imagine, from your accent, that you're not necessarily from Nashville here.
Right.
Yeah, so where are you from?
So I was born in Romania, communist Romania. So when I was born, it was very controlling. It was ruled by a dictatorship, by a dictator. So Christianity was not allowed. People think socialism is good. I got another thing to tell them. It's not good. It's a lot of control. Food was scarce. Hot water was once a day. Electricity twice a day given. So, yeah. So that's what I grew up in until I was 9.
And what happened at the age of 9?
Well, the reason that I'm doing this is because I have tapped and seen the supernatural presence of God intervene in our natural world in such a huge way ever since I was a little child.
Wow.
It started way back, even I remember things even since I was a baby. However, in this particular situation, I was 7 years old when my parents decided, based on the promises of the Lord, to try to escape communist Romania.
Wow.
Now, to try to paint a picture of that, when you are captured, or if you are captured on the border, and there were a lot of informers around, your neighbor can be an informer, a family member, because then they would be paid by the security police, okay? So to try to escape communist Romania and to be captured meant you were killed.
Wow.
Like beaten to where you were dead. It meant you being attacked by wolf dogs that they had trained that you are their meal.
Actual wolf dogs? These are actual wolves?
Actually wolf dogs.
Okay. Wow.
So that's, and as a 7-year-old child, I understood the danger of it, but yet I was so excited to go to this land of milk and honey. It's like I saw the goal, I didn't focus on the fear of it. And as a 7-year-old child, I was the youngest of, I have 2 older brothers of 3 siblings.
Okay.
And so in that time, I tell you what, we got captured the first time. Wolf dogs came. They sniffed me. They were ready to rip at my throat. The Lord took me out. There were angels that appeared on the border leading us back. My father was lost on the border. He's not dead, but he was lost. Another amazing, powerful story.
Did you know, would your parents clue you in as to, like, all right, we're going to try to escape? Or was it always kind of a surprise? Like, come on, let's go. Like, would they kind of clue you in as to what the plan was going to look like?
Well, they did not until we reached a village. And from there, we had to take another train to go to another village that was on the outskirts of the borders. So that's when my father, I remember, he pulled me over. He opened up his pig leather coat. And he said, lay down. I lay down on it, on the grass, the wet grass. And that's when he said to me, he said, baby, we're going to try to escape to America.
Wow.
And that word America was like, America. Oh my gosh, America. It was like this amazing, and then of course, because you have to understand, in those trains, there were border patrol that would go and stop at every person and look. And if you were found even with a little bit of suspicion, they would beat you off the train. And I saw that with my own eyes.
Wow.
So even as a 7-year-old child, I had to act normal, So, but ever since then, seeing the supernatural power and presence of God has has put in me this destiny that I am to walk in that. And not only that, but my desire is whatever I learn, whatever I walk in, I want to present it to whosoever chooses. Because what we're doing is not what we're supposed to be doing.
Yeah.
We're barely tapping
right.
in the little bit that Jesus said for us to do. And we're missing the fullness. Now remember, Jesus said, we are supposed to do everything that he has done. And let's just break down some of the stuff. He walked on water, walked through walls, walked through people. He made substance out of nothing.
Yeah.
And then he says, not everything that I wrote has been written down, because then there would not be enough libraries in the world.
That's right. That's
now
right.
Do that.
Right.
And then more.
Right. Right.
And then, like I say, a lot of times we can't even pray a headache away. And then
right,
and then we look around us and we see the atrocities that are happening. And I have a big desire to see that stop. And you know what? The angels are not going to do it because it's not their job.
Mm-hmm.
Their job is to come assist the sons that know who they are, that have awakened out of their spiritual amnesia, and go do the stuff.
Come on.
So all of creation, all these babies that are being sacrificed, you know, I know it's taboo for the church a lot of times, but all these things that are being done to children, the sex trafficking, mm-hmm. this torture, this luciferic, nasty, perverted sacrifices that are happening, they're crying, waiting for me,
right.
for us to go
right.
and do something.
Right.
So it's not, you know, just praising the Lord. It's us actually going into the heart of the Father out of relationship. Because in the heart of the Father is the fullness of everything that he has created that's part of our destiny. It's so much more than the love that we've heard, you know?
Yeah, like, that's right.
Love is actually not a feeling. It's the ultimate source of power and energy that is the essence of God. And it flows out as the river of glory that goes and creates what is not there.
Awesome. So you're raised in this very intense environment.
Mm-hmm.
Your parents are like, we're getting out. We're going to America. Here we go.
Yep.
And you are immediately exposed to these intense environments.
Absolutely.
But they're like integrated with the supernatural.
Yes.
So like you're actually seeing angels guiding you guys.
Oh, yeah.
Like, so it's like the supernatural wasn't just this luxury. It wasn't just this you know,
right.
angels.
Yeah.
It was like, this was like life or death.
It
like,
literally was.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. And so that shaped what was normal for you.
Yeah, absolutely.
When it comes to the supernatural, that the supernatural is not just this thing that we have to sell books. Like it's a life or death.
Yeah.
Like heaven on earth. This is like, this is a confrontational objective.
Yep.
Not just this idea to build these beautiful atmospheres where people feel good.
Right. Absolutely. And you know, that's why I think in the Western world, we don't see as much of the supernatural because we have not yet been at that place. Mm-hmm. Of life and death. Like, I need you, like, right now.
It's like
you said, it's more of a, you know, ooh, you know, I see angels. No. And this is what, you know, God wants us to understand, that in the darkest of our situation, if we allow him and if we engage with and step outside of fear and what the tradition Christianity has taught us, there, he will open up the spirit realm so that we can tap in and see the help coming from above. Because I tell you what, like in that situation, we had to run because the guards heard us. My dad wasn't coming back because he went ahead to check the grounds for any booby traps or any guards, you know. And we were with another couple with a 3 or 6 month old baby. And they gave the baby sleeping syrup, which we had in Romania, mm-hmm. that knocked the baby out. So you can cross the border with the baby. So as we were waiting for my dad.
It's like Jaeger.
There you go. Yeah.
right.
Yeah.
Cough syrup. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So as we were waiting for my dad, the wolf dog sensed us.
Wow.
So they were alerted that there is somebody trying to escape.
Wow.
Okay. And then in that time, the baby woke up screaming on the border.
Wow.
Now get up. It's mm-hmm. raining, it's pouring,
mm-hmm.
and try to find the village. Here you are on land. All you can see is land and little tiny villages, like little lights flickering in the distance. Try to find the exact village. And not only that, but get from that village, jump over fences to where cows are not mooing, to where chickens are not chicketing to where dogs are not barking, to jump over fences to get to the exact house where you left from.
Wow.
So we had to get up, we had to run, guards are hearing us, babies crying, and all of a sudden the angels, an angel of the Lord appeared and guided us, hear me, to the exact village. We jumped over fences of homes in that village. Not one animal made a sound. Not one person found us. And that's just one.
That's incredible. Did your parents see that? Like, were your parents supernaturalists? Or was this, like, just you as a little girl with your eyes open?
No. My older brother and I saw it. My parents didn't see it. So wow. There was a conflict because the couple that was there was like, I'm not following a 13-year-old child, you know, because that's my older brother was 13 at that wow. time. I was 7. So, and my mom chose. She said, you know what? We're going. So I'm telling you, it's amazing what God will do when we allow it. And just one more thing to share with you.
Yeah.
When this the same time we tried to escape twice. The first time we lost my dad on the border, we had to go back. The second time we got captured.
Wow.
Yeah. So I actually have a book about it because the miracles of God are so... If people can just understand the God that we serve and the God that is actually our Father, if we really, really understood our identity in who we are in Him, mm-hmm. I think we would go through life and through these attacks that the enemy throws much faster and much easier because we would realize our position. So anyway, this other time we had to cross big mud canals because they had mud canals full of mud, hoping that when you would try to cross them, you would drown.
Wow.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we had to cross this huge mud canal, and my parents and that couple realized that they're going around in circles. We were supposed to get to the Yugoslavian border, all the way to Yugoslavia. And it was getting, you know, the time was ticking, mm-hmm. and they realized they're going in circles and circles. And all of a sudden, my parents stopped, and that couple, and my mom prayed. She said, Lord, lead us out like you led the Israelites with a tower of fire and a cloud by day. And you know what? I tell you what, all of a sudden, there was a small cloud that appeared in the dark sky, small.
Wow.
And it literally led us. It waited over the canal till we crossed, and then it led us on the right path.
Wow, that's incredible.
So this is who we serve.
That's right.
This is who we serve. So that's why I have such a passion and a desire to introduce people to these things, that this is real. This is not fairy tale. This is not the devil. This is not witchcraft. This is not New Age. Because I tell you what, the devil will never try to tell you to get closer to God.
The devil
will never teach you how to access the heart of the Father and tap into that relationship and the most intimate part of who God is, which is His heart. He would never do that.
That's right.
So this is what I always tell people. No matter how crazy these things sound, no matter how you don't have a grid for, if at the very core of what you're hearing is relationship with God, and you knowing who you are, that ain't the devil.
That's right.
And on the other flip side, no matter how comfortable a message makes you, no matter how, you know, you raise your hands and, oh, I heard this from my grandfather and so on and so forth, if it denies the fullness of who you are in and through Christ and the way that He made for you, that death is not my entry point.
That's right.
Kingdom of my Father. It's Jesus Christ. He made a way for me to be in there now, that as He is now. How does Jesus look right now glorified? As He is right now, so am I now in this world.
Yeah, come on.
Okay? So if we understand that, then if the enemy denies that, then it's no matter how comfortable this message makes you feel, mm-hmm. that is a doctrine of demons, because it's trying to deny who you really are and God's power operating in and through you. Because the enemy knows God is powerful, but he does not want you to realize, the Antichrist spirit does not want you and me to realize the power of God working in and through you and me.
Yeah, that's awesome. Now, within your own experience, within your own story, because what I see and what everybody will see when they're watching this is this very intense and intentional mm-hmm. Person that's developed this furious jealousy for intimacy with Christ. Like, I see that. I see that in you. Now, has that always been that way, or did you ever come into this place within your own spirituality once you came to America, mm-hmm. where it wasn't like this, and it was more religious, and there was this moment of reawakening into. So what did that? Yeah. What is this journey? I mean, have Good you always question. Just been? Have yeah. you always just been like, here we go, mm-hmm. you know, yeah, you know, or was there ever this moment where you were more, where you kind of drank the American right. Kool-Aid?
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah, well, great question. So you know, when I came to America, I was 9 and a half, and that summer mm-hmm. we were invited to go to a prayer meeting. Now I was raised Pentecostal Romanian.
Okay.
We don't have blue hair.
This is good. Like hair in the bun, that whole thing. Like,
yeah, yeah, absolutely. Scarf and
no makeup.
No makeup. Yeah. You know, now, you know, I came from one of the largest city in Romania, and they were more modern.
Okay.
But from the villages, oh yeah, it was crazy strict.
Okay.
Like no watches, sure, you know, sure. all of that. Okay. So at that age, when we went to the prayer meeting, so I knew, you know, the Holy Spirit, I've always been like this. Okay. I've always been passionate, a passionate person. Listen, we were in that prayer meeting, about 50 people there. And I remember being on my knees, and this is what I said to the Lord. I said, Jesus, I heard that a 5-year-old little girl received the filling of the Holy Spirit mm-hmm. with the evidence of speaking in tongues. I am 9 and a half. I want it. I will not get up off my knees until I do not receive it. I want to speak with you in heavenly tongues. I want it, Jesus. Give it to me. Give it to me. Listen to me. That desire in me so drew the presence of God that not only did His Spirit come and fill me, but all of a sudden the prophetic mantle fell on me.
Wow.
So the Lord literally took me. I was levitating off my knees. I was on my knees, up and down like a bouncing ball, maybe 2 feet off the ground.
Wow.
And the Lord took me to each person that was there, mm-hmm. and He was reading their mail. Now, my parents were freaking out. And when that was over, they had to...
Like freaking out in a good way? Like, our daughter!
Well,
or like,
no. Like freaking out going, she's so young. What do we do with this? How do we steward this?
Wow.
And they had to change my clothes twice. Because I was drenched. That's how the fire of God came so strong over me and in me. So I was always radical for Him. But I did grow up in a Romanian Pentecostal religion, the church. Mm-hmm. So the encounters that I had with the Lord, the desire for me to see Him. And I was like, I don't have to die to see you. But that was never preached. Wow. You understand?
Right, right.
It was, you have to have a death experience in order to maybe see Jesus.
Right.
But you cannot just close your eyes and desire and be in the presence of heaven and the presence of Jesus. You cannot see God because you would die.
That's right.
So that's what I grew. Yet I've experienced that. Mm-hmm. So throughout my years, I would have encounters and experiences that I could not really share. And then, you know, fast forward, the encounters and the experiences grew and became more tangible and more real. But again, I would only share them with my husband because, you know, I mean, you know, it's crazy. And then in 2013, my spiritual mom introduced me to Ian Clayton's teachings.
In 2013?
2013.
Okay, all right.
And it blew me away and I fell on my face and I was like, thank you, Jesus, thank you. Here is somebody that understands, oh my gosh, I am really, really, really not crazy.
And what teaching was it? Do you remember that first teaching?
I think it was separating the spirit, soul, and body.
Yeah, okay. Yep.
Okay, so yep. I was like, and that's when the Lord told me, I will connect you and you will bring Him over. And I was laughing. I'm like, I don't even know where this guy's from. I know he has an accent, but I don't know where he's from. And God is so faithful because a year after I met Him, and it so happened that the Lord had him come to Nashville and our ministry, Kingdom Reflections, was the one chosen by the Lord to do it. So wow. I obeyed. I'm like, okay, Daddy,
yeah.
I don't have a team.
Yeah.
I'm willing. Because this is, you know, when you have a desire and a love for the Father, whatever He asks you, you're going to say yes to. And then in midair, you're like, you are going to catch me, right? You know, so I have always been this passionate. I've always had the passion because I know this is part of who I am. This is my blueprint to be a very passionate person in everything I do. Really, I am. But when you encounter the Lord in such deep ways, there is no way that I cannot be like that. So, yes, you know, I did not drink the Kool-Aid. But I was questioning myself, like, Lord, is this you? How come nobody else is having these encounters?
How come I don't really fit in this?
And I've
thing.
Never fit.
Yeah.
I have never, ever fit.
Yeah.
So, and, you know, so the more I grew in the Lord and all these things, and then God confirming these radical encounters through Ian, You know, I was like, oh my gosh. It's almost like the Lord said, let loose and fly.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And now this is what I do.
So what was that like? That first time that you hosted Ian here in Nashville?
You know, it's it was scary. Mm-hmm. You know, I've never hosted anybody. I've always...
Because events are interesting.
Well,
because you never know who's going to come.
Well, and see, I don't know any of that because I've always been the one going and ministering. I've never been one to host. And it's like the Lord gave me one of the, you know, not biggest fish, but, you know, a king really to host. And I'm like, I don't have a budget for this. Oh, my gosh. I don't have a team. Right. Oh, my gosh. And the Lord said to me, Corina, will you do it? I didn't ask you what you have. Will you do it? And I said, Daddy, of course I'll do it. I'll do anything for you. Anything that you ask me to do, you know I'll do. And I said yes. And the rest, you know. Now, it was hard because, you know, Nashville was not ready for this. It was not. 2015, Nashville was not ready for this. I mean, this is the Bible Belt.
Wow, right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Even for charismatics, even for non-denominational. Mm-hmm. There's only a step that we take. A level, I'm talking about levels,
sure.
And then we park at that.
Sure, sure, sure.
Okay, and this meant that we have to let go of what we knew and say, but there's more. And it's our choice if we're gonna jump in or stay back.
Yeah.
So with Ian coming, it was you know, a little bit difficult because the leaders were so afraid.
Yeah, and Ian's interesting too because Ian has never been a very public ministry, you know, so it's not like... You know, you're never going to see, like, I mean, I shouldn't say this, but traditionally, up to present, you've never seen, like, a sponsored ad by Ian trying to sell an e-course or something.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
No.
Like, he's always been, and especially in 2013, 14, 15, there was very little. Like,
absolutely.
There were, like, these YouTube videos that were, like, fifth generation, seventh generation
right.
YouTube videos that were just horrible quality. Like, that's really all that you could find.
Correct.
Yeah, so all there was, I think, is these stories or rumors or gossip.
See, absolutely.
You know, and being a pastor, I would hear these. In fact, I would hear the same story, hybrids of the same story in seven different ways. But it was always to a different person. It was always kind of... And so when I met Ian, I, like, you know, you meet him, you sit across the table, you see this is a guy who loves Jesus.
Absolutely.
His messages. But I've found that with Ian hasn't really been the problem. Sometimes it's other people that are preaching his sermons and are doing it correctly.
Right.
You know, they're forgetting details and they're like, you know, so
right.
But once I actually met him, this guy loves Jesus. He's not a sorcerer.
Absolutely. Like,
you know what I'm saying? And but I understand what you're talking about.
Yeah, it was a lot of fear, you know, on leaders, and because my heart was to invite all the leaders to come in, you know, for free, just come.
So that's what you were doing. You invited all the different leaders in the area to come.
Yeah, and you know, and it didn't happen.
Yeah, I love that you were just, you know, very innocent and just like, this is all true for the kingdom.
Like
to come.
A child, you know, just go out there and just, you know, and I would send Facebook messages and text messages and emails and, you know, but that's okay.
Yeah,
you know, that's great. Okay, because God has it all in His hand and His plan. And I tell you what, since then, because Ian is a breaker.
Yeah.
And he's the father of this amazing movement, and I so honor him. And I have to, okay, I'm going to finish this point, then I have to go back and tell you something else about Ian that I so love, 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 love. Both Steve and I, my husband, so love about him. So anyway, but he's the father in this movement, and today, in 2019, the atmosphere in Nashville has so shifted because of what this great general of God has brought in the area. Because I tell you what, Justin Abraham came this year, springtime. That would have never opened up for Justin had Ian not come as a breaker like 3 years in a row and just break it, Lord, break it. So Justin Abraham brought the stuff in, and it was so amazing. So I love how the Lord builds one layer at a time, you know, and releases His reflection of who He is through us, through whosoever chooses to allow Him to reflect. So, but I do got to share this with you about Ian. First time we brought him, you know, I was nervous, you know, and he was so down to earth. You know, even my husband, even Steve said, he doesn't have to sit there and preach. It's just the kingdom of God is flowing out of his heart. And you know what Ian said to me? Sunday we had a core meeting with Ian so they can ask him questions. And he said to me, Corina, after we're done with this, I want to go home and spend time with your family, with Steve and the kids.
Wow. Right. Right. Right.
I mean, you know.
Yeah.
How many ministers say that?
I know.
That was his agenda. He said, I cannot wait. When this is done, I want to go home and spend time with you and the kids. And at that point, my 26-year-old was working he was 20 or something like that. I don't remember. He was doing his work in Nashville, selling stuff anyway. And Ian actually wanted to go see him. So it's just...
That's cool. Yeah.
So it's a man that really carries the heart of the Father. So anyway, that's why I honor him so much. So yeah.
Yeah, he's highly relational and just so open for just hanging out.
Yeah.
And you can talk... I mean, you could probably talk... You know, you could talk about spiritual things,
Yeah.
Or you could talk about just practical things.
Right.
You could talk about food or sports.
Yeah,
right. And so, yeah.
Yeah.
No, that's amazing. Now, let's talk about Nashville.
Yeah.
Let's talk about this very... You know, so you've been here since 95.
Since 96.
96.
Yeah.
And you've seen a huge shift.
I have.
What's it like here?
Well,
just being who you are and kind of functioning what you function, and what are some of the things that you notice and that you maybe hit up against, or maybe even just some of the cool opportunities where you feel like it's.
Yeah. Well, you know, obviously when I came in 96, the atmosphere was completely different. It was very religious. And the reason I came is because I was part of the worship team for TBN. So I came for TBN.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. So,
I'll just move this in just a little bit.
Sure. Which, you know, and TBN is, the atmosphere there was totally different. It was a revival.
Now, on TBN, purple, blue hair?
No, blonde.
Blonde, okay,
yes.
All right.
I was
all
the
right.
safe color.
All right, awesome. Because it's not uncommon to see purple hair on TBN, but okay, so blonde.
Right.
All right, got it.
Right. But even the colors that I have is specifically for the time and the season that God has me in. That is connected to frequencies.
So your hair is like a prophetic drama.
Oh, absolutely. Like,
That's awesome.
Absolutely. I was pink before Nashville even had a color of pink. They had to order it from Europe.
Really?
Yeah.
Awesome.
So,
come on.
So anyway. But so the atmosphere here back then was quite religious, and a lot was focused on revivals.
Okay.
You know? And even now. But the Lord, again, with everything with God, we're supposed to move from glory to glory.
Amen.
We're not supposed to park and take roots at any move of God.
Amen.
Because once we do, we're stagnant.
Amen.
God wants to stretch us, because in that stretching process, it means we're growing. So that means we have to move out of our comfortable situation and go into a situation that is not very comfortable.
Amen.
Because that's where He brings a stretch. So, you know, the Lord right now is looking. He told me in 2015, I was in Scotland on the Hebrides Island, where on Lewis Island, from where one of the great revivals started in the early 1900s, I believe. So the Lord, you know, I had this open vision, and I'm not going to get into details of it, but this is what He said, Corina. Revival, as great as it was a move of the past.
Mm-hmm.
Because it brought revival in a little region or area. Hundreds of people got revived. But what I'm bringing right now, what I'm releasing, is a spirit of revolution.
Mm.
And when the voices of the past, the revival, the ancient wells are springing. Okay, the ancient wells are rumbling. And when they hear the cry of the spirit of revolution, it's going to meet in the air, and it's going to be an explosion.
Yeah.
Because let me tell you something. There is a problem if we keep having to be revived.
Yeah, right.
Dead, revived,
right,
dead,
sure,
revived.
Sure.
So the Lord, what's going to change us is when the spirit of revolution is going to hit the sleeping ones, the sleeping sons, out of their spiritual amnesia. And when we hear the spirit of revolution crying and saying, let me show you who you are, because the spirit of revelation is going to show you who you are. And when you awaken into the realization, wait a minute, you mean I don't have to wait until I'm dead to do all these things? You mean I'm not a slave? You mean I do not have to submit to these trading floors that my family line has traded on? You mean I can do all those things that Jesus said now? Then you're going to revolt against the spirit of control, the spirit of religion, and then we're going to step in our position and bring a reformation and release the kingdom government of our God, not only here.
That's right.
But
that's
in
right.
all of creation.
Come on.
So revival was awesome, but we parked there. And God says, no, it's about a revolution. Because then a revival is going to hit the globe and all of creation that is birthed out of a revolution, out of the warriors rising up into who they are.
That's good. That's
so
really
anyway,
good.
So, you know, good. So Nashville was very based on that. And I'm seeing now more of a shift, especially with this mystic move.
Sure.
That's happening. So, yeah.
No, that's awesome. Now, so my background, so this is kind of fun. So the church where I'm the pastor of is called Seattle Revival Center.
Okay.
You know, I'm tracking with what you're saying. Uh-huh. And kind of what I think is that, like, anytime you got these words that we use in Christendom, we begin to kind of use them based off of a framework of the past.
Correct.
But we do that with all kinds of words. And I definitely think that that happens with revival. Like you say revival, you immediately think of, you might think of the 90s. You might think of 1906. You might think of all these different things. Mm-hmm. But when I use the word revival, I think of it as a portal.
Yes.
As a doorway.
Yeah.
Where there's an invitation from Father to step in through, to enter into the adventure of the kingdom and to step into a new world. But I think it's just the doorway.
Yeah.
It's just that access point from the old. So like, so I know it's just, but you can ask 100 people, what's revival? And you're going to get 100 different answers.
Absolutely.
But I see it as it's the wardrobe that takes you into Narnia. It's it's the rabbit hole. It's not about the wardrobe though.
Yeah.
It's but I like, so that's part of my blueprint is creating wardrobes, creating portals, but not to get hung up on.
Yeah.
Because not about the wardrobe.
No.
It's about Narnia. It's about the kingdom. It's about those realms, you
absolutely.
Know?
Absolutely.
And so because I think it's super easy. I heard a story recently about, I don't know, Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones. I don't know if you
know. I don't know.
He was a Welsh kind of, he was a Welsh pastor, but he was born just after the Welsh Revival.
Uh-huh.
So he was born just after that thing ended. And he talks about growing up in this environment where he watched the older generation try to tap dance and drum up the experience of the, I mean, imagine being you hear about the people that were alive during it, during the move.
Right.
But thinking about the kids that were born just after it ended.
Right.
And he was talking about this place of like that every time, you know, about these portals that you can never enter into the kingdom through the same portal twice.
You cannot.
And that's where there needs to be a generation that's courageous, that's creative, in order to begin to take people from earth into the into that place of the, you go into this realm, and then you come back.
Correct.
You realize that that's what we need is a revolution.
Absolutely.
Because what we're being told is the truth is not the truth.
Yeah.
And there's so much cope.
Absolutely.
And the culture, or even in the church, there's so much like, kind of people pointing fingers and blaming and all that kinds of things.
Yeah, well, you know, when this happened, this encounter happened, and again, it happened on Lewis Island, and that's when Trump was running for, that's when he just announced it.
Yep.
I don't know anything about it, I don't, you know. And so the way it started is I heard the rumblings of the ancient wells.
Wow.
We were driving through the Hebrides, and I kept hearing the war cry. I literally heard the warriors, and I heard their swords clinging. And I particularly heard William Wallace.
Wow.
I mean, all over through those islands, through the Hebrides. Oh my gosh, I was bawling. I'm like, Daddy, why am I hearing this? So we got on Lewis Island overlooking the ocean. And all of a sudden, I heard the rumblings of, I heard the cries of the ancient wells, the revival. And the Lord, that's when he said to me, he said, Corina, I'm doing a new thing. I'm releasing a new sound. Look what sound. So he said, look up. And when I looked up, this water, I heard the sound of this torrent of water, and it was so loud that I literally covered my head and I looked down. That's how scary it sounded. He goes, no, look up. And I looked up. And when this was heard, the ancient wells, all of a sudden the water came up, and the two of them met.
Oh,
and he said, this is what I'm doing. I'm releasing a new thing, and it's revolution. And then he said, and Trump is going to be part of this revolution.
Really?
Yeah, and I don't know nothing. I did not know anything about Trump. You know, I mean, I didn't care for Trump.
Yeah.
Now it's a different story.
Right.
But
right,
you know what I'm saying? So look around. It's just the spirit of just compromise. We're calling yes, no. We're calling no, yes. We're calling black, white, white, black.
That's right.
Everything's upside down. Unless a spirit of revolution comes on the scene and us, we're going to keep being stagnant, and the enemy will keep taking ground because this is what is happening. But the moment we just allow that spirit to hit you, I'm telling you, you and I, we will revolt against the lies of the enemy and step up into the fullness. Now, I'm not talking about a partial. I'm talking about the fullness of everything that Jesus gave you and me access to. And that is only found in and through the heart of God. That's why relationship is so huge.
That's good.
It's not that God wants, you know, he's this God that just love on me, just love me. No, God knows that if we understand that everything was birthed out of his heart, the most intimate place of God is his heart. And love is the essence of his heart. And love is the creative force. Even Einstein talked about it. This is what I'm going to talk about at the conference.
Awesome.
You know, love is the most powerful force that creates. Love is not a word, you know, greasy love or hyper love that we can just use as a rug to cover the poop,
yeah,
crap.
Yeah.
Can I say that?
Poo-poo,
dumb. And then we keep, yeah, and then we keep sweeping the poo-poo,
yeah,
and the garbage under this rug that we call love.
Right.
And then we don't realize what happens. You get flies and maggots. Love is actually the most powerful energy and source because it flows out of God, and everywhere it goes, it creates. So that's why God knew if they understand that the relationship is the key for them to step into the fullness of what I have for them, they would never question it. But yet we settle for the little, the less.
Right, right, right. So you're sensing that the rumblings of revolution
absolutely
right now in Tennessee.
Since 2015 it started. And now it's even more because the people from the area are coming along. They're realizing that there's more. You know, they're realizing that it's not just what they've heard. And they're daring to step in.
Yeah. Let's talk about Kingdom Reflections. Is
yes.
What's the vision there?
The vision of Kingdom Reflection is to teach identity, and to draw people in understanding that you have access to step into the chambers of God's heart.
Awesome. And what's the platforms for that? Are you guys actually meeting, doing gatherings, or are you doing more online?
I travel.
Okay.
I travel.
Awesome.
I do gatherings sometimes here, but you know we have conferences here in Nashville.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I travel, and then we also have a TV ministry.
Oh, awesome.
Played on Christian television networks, unveiling the mysteries of sonship.
Oh, really? What networks? Like, are they
CTN, Christian Television Network?
Awesome.
So it's going, you know, in their networks and different states, and also a Vimeo channel, and we're releasing another channel that's called The Quest for Truth.
Really? Amazing.
Yeah. So we're doing quite a bit of things, but it's more not so much where I'm like a church here.
Yeah.
It's just, you know, I do conferences and I travel. So.
And Vimeo?
I'm Vimeo.
Is that cool? Is that a cool place to be?
It's very good. Thanks to Wendy. Yeah. You need to talk to Wendy. She's amazing at that. Yeah.
Is she?
Yes.
Right.
She's phenomenal.
Hi, Wendy. Wendy's over there, everybody. Really cool.
Yeah.
Because not very many people are utilizing that platform.
It's a very good platform.
Yeah. Awesome.
It's a very, very good.
I should say not very many people, but not very many ministers that I know that are kind of...
It's better than YouTube for multiple reasons.
Okay, all right,
but
awesome.
You could talk to Wendy.
All right, now the Mystic Camp.
Yeah.
What are you seeing, because you're kind of on the inside of kind of this Christian mystic movement.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there's rumblings of revolution within that camp as well, isn't there?
Yes,
A lot of transition, a lot of stuff taking place. What do you see God doing actually within this modern mystic movement right now?
Well, God, what I see him doing is he has sent out an invitation for whosoever chooses to step into the more. And unfortunately, you know, even in this mystic move, we got so excited that we can do all these stuff, and we kind of forgot that we shouldn't run after doing the stuff, but run after the heart of God.
Wow.
So there has been some issues there too.
Right.
Because the enemy's very fast. If you just want power, he's very fast to give it to you.
Yeah, it's true. It's
okay.
True. Yeah.
So what I see right now is the Lord more, he's released this invitation for whosoever chooses to go deeper. Because remember, the Bible says many are called, but few are chosen.
Mm-hmm.
And I never quite understood that. It's like, and the Lord said, Corina, it's your choice that chooses you.
Wow.
It's not that, I choose you because I like you. I skip you. No, my choice chooses me. It's for whosoever. So in this move right now, I see the Lord sending out an invitation for whosoever chooses to step into the next place, which is his heart. Because when you are in his heart, which is relationship, because when you're in his heart, the fullness of everything that he has for you is there. And there's no counterfeit because you are, everything you're doing now, it's coming from love, from your relationship with God the Father. It's not, oh, because I want to just go and build a planet. Oh, I just want to, you know, I don't know, get drunk in heaven. Oh, I just want to walk through this wall. Do you understand?
Yeah, totally.
The purpose and the foundation of your desire now becomes, oh, you mean I can enter your heart? You mean I have access, like literally? Oh, I want to go there. I want to know you. I want to know the most intimate part of you, Father, your heart. Yes, that needs to be our focus.
Yeah.
And I think in this mystic move right now, the Lord is calling those. You know, there's a separation in everything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. That's
you
right.
Understand what I'm saying? So I think this is what the Lord is trying to do right now.
Yeah, well, that's really good. Yeah, that's awesome. And from what I've heard is Marios is really going after relationship.
I tell you what, I heard Marios at several conferences. Ian introduced me to him in 2017. And I had the honor of Marios joining us last year also in Nashville with Ian. And I tell you what, I have been so blessed, Steve and I, to see the authenticity of this man. There were situations where I saw him choose honor.
Wow.
Above and beyond, that brought me to tears.
Wow.
This man is so amazing. In other words, what he preaches, he walks it.
Wow.
That's why, and I know you know, met Marios, that's why the hand of the Lord is so strong on this man, and the wisdom of God is so powerful in and through him, because he has learned how to walk with honor and favor. And if we don't have honor, we're not going to get God's favor. Now, we can get men's favor, but that's not the same.
Yeah, that's right.
So I so love what Marios brings. You know, Ian brings these like, whoa, my head hurts, you know, kind of things like, what, you know, my brain tilt, you know.
Right.
And Marios brings this like, whoa, you know, he just brings it. And I'm in between.
Yeah.
So anyway, sure. But Marios is so amazing. I so honor him. I really do. What he carries is so true. You know, I love walking with ministers that what they preach, they actually do in their everyday life when nobody sees it.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
And I can tell you, both Marios and Ian are just that. And I love it. I absolutely honor them.
Yeah. Well, so, I'm excited for your conference next week.
Thank you.
By the time this actually comes out, it'll be long past.
Yeah, it'll be amazing.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, how are you positioning yourself when it comes to 2020? Are there, in Kingdom Reflections, and how are you kind of gearing up for kind of the next 12 months? I think it's kind of an interesting time. I know with Rosh Hashanah and the mm-hmm. Hebrew New Year's that we're coming into right now.
Mm-hmm.
But also just, I love seasons just mm-hmm. in the natural, because mm-hmm. it gives us opportunity to have launching points and also periods where we're reevaluating our rhythms.
Yeah.
And so as far as what you're feeling in the spirit, the opportunities that are closing mm-hmm. and opening, How are you guys kind of gearing up, whether it's in Nashville or just your ministry gearing up for what the Lord has in this next season?
Yeah, well, you know, again, even with that, my heart's desire for every season that I'm in, every season, you know, be it the ministry, be it our personal life, be it whatever mandate the Lord gives me, is to go and release the blueprint of God.
Okay.
So that's my heart. So I know, what I know right now is that the heart of the Lord is so crying out, if you will, for us to get in our position, because mm-hmm. what's coming down the pike is not necessarily going to be very wonderful.
Yeah. Yeah.
You understand what I'm
right,
saying?
Right.
But it is going to be wonderful for us because we have an opportunity to step in there and shine. I'm not talking about cliche shine. Oh, you know, shine. No, I'm talking about literally shine the creative power of God's love that, again, is not a feeling. It's a force. To bring change. In other words, I believe the Lord is going to give up. There's going to be an opportunity globally, yeah. nationally,
yeah.
State-wise, personally, in our families, in our regions, where we're going to have to step up. Where we will have to step up.
Yeah.
And be who we're supposed to be.
That's good.
Do you understand what
yeah,
I'm saying?
Absolutely.
Because when we look at martyrs in different countries, they stepped up. And they were what they're supposed to be.
That's right.
And it cost them. What makes us think that we can sit, hear my heart though.
Yeah.
You know, and just sip our coffees and do our little church And I love church.
Right. Sure.
And
sure.
I honor you, Pastor. Yeah, sure. But no, hear my heart.
Right.
You know, we have to stop playing and step up. It's a calling of stepping up as mature sons so that we can be presented to the Father and He can anoint us as kings and appoint us as priests under the order of Melchizedek. Meaning, He's looking for mature sons to be anointed as kings. So we are kings out of sonship, which means we have the full authority of the entire kingdom government, angels, spiritual beings of God that's backing us up now. It's not that I'm just a mere king, but not a son. There's a difference, is that I am a king birthed out of the maturity process of a son. And now I have the full authority of my Father to back me up. And no matter what the situation looks like now in 2020, I know what I'm called to release, and I will see a shift and the changes according to the desire of the Father. I think it's an opportunity for us to step up and release what's in us from Him.
Yeah, awesome. Yeah, so good. So good. And one of the things that I hear through everything that you're saying, there's like this justice frequency on everything that you're saying. Yeah. What's your revelation of justice? I mean, there's got to be like that must be a core value of yours.
It is, and it's funny, you're going to freak out actually about this. It's so cool. I love it.
Yeah.
Justice is huge to me, and I realize that it's not because I mustered it up. It's because it's in my blueprint. It's in my DNA. Being a little girl, I grew up, you know, when we came to America, cartoons. I mean, oh my gosh, Saturday night cartoons. Mm-hmm. My mom would, Saturday morning cartoons. And I was always drawn to the Justice Leagues. I was always drawn to the, you know, and my thing, I wanted to be Firestar.
Okay. Yeah, awesome.
Okay.
Yeah.
So this justice thing, and I realized the more I grew, I would feel this this justice rise up in me. And it's so strong in me that actually in 2013, we had our fifth child be born. One of them is with the Lord, a little girl. So he's our first fifth child. And I was for sure, it was a surprise. Not for my hubby, because I'm sure he had many talks with the Lord that I was left outside of those talks.
All right,
okay.
All right,
so,
all right.
But I thought it was going to be a girl because the little girl that we had before then, I thought, oh, maybe it's a sister for her, you know?
Right.
And then the Lord spoke. Hear me. The Lord spoke to me. You are to call this baby Justice.
Wow. Wow.
And I was like, wait a minute. That's a boy's name. You know, so I thought. So listen, Cindy Jacobs was on TV one night. And, you know, so this is, I was already 4 months pregnant. Majesty, our little girl, was calling him Baby Justice, you know? And I said, Daddy, you really got to confirm to me if this is his name. Because I knew I carried this justice thing. So I turned on the TV. It was like 12:30 at night, you know, in the morning. And Cindy Jacobs is on TV. And, you know, she's talking. And I don't know. Are you familiar with Cindy Jacobs?
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
When the anointing comes on her, she just, you know, and she puts her hand in the camera and she says, thus saith the Lord. This is about justice. It's a season of justice. God is releasing justice. His Justice League. So I was like, oh, my gosh. So all this to say, the justice thing is, we are supernatural beings at the core. There is supernatural power in us that God has given to us. We must tap into that supernatural power to release the power and the glory and the justice of God. So justice, it's so funny you hit on it. It's a huge thing to me.
That's awesome. And you have a boy named Justice.
I have a boy named Justice.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Yeah.
And the Justice League thing definitely resonates with me as well. If in my office at home, so if we were doing this podcast in Seattle, I have an 8-foot by 4-foot mural of Superman with laser beams coming out of his eyes and blowing everything out. Mm-hmm. It's called the Burning Man. For me, it's like the picture of what a Christian should look like. The inverted believer with the glory coming out of the eyes, bringing justice. So that's awesome when you're talking about the Justice League and all of that. I just appreciate your heart and also just your willingness to make the drive over in the middle of the day and to battle Nashville traffic in order to have this conversation.
Thank
I'm also
so
really excited about everything that the Lord's doing with you in media and in the areas of justice and in this revolution rumble that's taking place here in Nashville.
Yeah.
And I feel like there's so much opportunity in the spirit.
There is.
I don't even know the pulse of this region, but just being here this last week, I feel like there's so many portals here. There are so many access points.
Yeah, there are many, many, many.
So
many,
you guys are at the right place.
Yeah, obviously.
The right
thank
time.
You. Yeah, yeah.
Also, we'll just encourage everyone listening as well to make sure that you check out all the show notes, because we'll put all the links to Kingdom Reflections and their events and everything else. So we'll make sure that we put everything there so that people can connect with you and your ministry. I've seen you on Facebook and everything. So when this connection happens, all right, this is great.
Yeah,
you
awesome.
Know?
Yeah.
Well, hey, God bless you. Thanks
Thank you
again.
So much for having me. I so appreciate it. It was wonderful to get to know you.
Absolutely. We'll do it again, maybe on the West Coast
maybe
next
on
time.
The West Coast, yeah.
All right,
Thank
awesome.
You.
All right, bless you.
Bless you.